Metanoia, from the Greek words meta, which means to change, and noia, which means mind. Metanoia therefore means to change your mind, to think in a new way, to shift your perspective. The purpose of this film is to promote a new way of thinking about nature, to show that nature is not some mindless array of bits and pieces, but rather a system of self-organizing intelligence. By the end of the film, it should be clear, beyond any reasonable doubt, that nature is intelligently configured and that this natural intelligence is evident in everything from the evolution of the universe to the evolution of life. But before we begin on this rather unorthodox voyage, it's instructive to look at a classic example of metanoia and the resistance it must often overcome before it can become common sense. Take the life and work of Italian astronomer Galileo. 400 years ago, Galileo armed himself with a newly invented telescope and set his sights on the heavens. Through his various observations, like his discovery that Venus went through phases, just like the moon goes through phases, Galileo became convinced that the Earth did not lie at the centre of the universe, as was commonly believed at that time. Like his predecessor Copernicus, Galileo realised that in order to make sense of celestial phenomena, the Sun had to lie at the centre of all the action. However, back in Galileo's day, our views of the universe were dictated solely by the Church, and the Church vigorously decreed that the Earth, and nothing but the Earth, lay at the centre of the universe. Period. Case closed. This view was so ingrained, so rigid, that anyone who challenged it was deemed guilty of heresy. Never mind what you could see through a telescope, it was what it said in the Bible that had priority. And the Old Testament clearly stated that the earth was fixed and unmovable. Given that Galileo was very influential and wrote enthusiastically about a sun-centered view of the heavens, he was eventually summoned to Rome and had to face the dreaded Inquisition. He was interrogated, prodded, browbeaten, and told in no uncertain terms to recant his views. So dangerous was Galileo judged to be, so keen was the church to maintain the Earth at the center of the universe, that Galileo spent the last years of his life under house arrest. He was lucky not to have been burned at the stake. Nowadays, we take it for granted that the Earth revolves around the Sun. But this dramatic change in perspective, this metanoia, was a long time in coming. The lesson to be learned from Galileo is that our view of the universe and our position within it are hard to shift. There is inertia, and often a hierarchical priesthood of some kind, that polices and force feeds a dogmatic view of reality. In Galileo's day, this was the Catholic Church. Today, at least in the West, there's been a rather ironic role reversal. It's now our scientific institutions that decree the meaning of life, the universe, and everything. And here's the rub. The science taught in all our schools, colleges, and universities tells us that we live in a non-intelligent universe, that nature is dumb, mindless, and essentially a meaningless accident. The Earth may indeed rotate about the Sun according to precision-based natural law, and we humans may well be the outcome of nature's subtle evolutionary laws. And yet these laws of nature are deemed to be devoid of intelligence and design. Yet this is wrong. Indeed, nothing, absolutely nothing, could be further from the truth. In today's climate of materialism and reductionism, the idea that nature has intelligent characteristics smacks of heresy. After all, we've become so alienated from nature that intelligence, learning, and creativity are attributed almost exclusively to ourselves. We are smart, nature is dumb and mindless. We can design, nature can only fumble blindly. And yet all the evidence gathered by science actually points to an intelligent universe, that nature is everywhere expressing itself in deliberately constructive ways. Nowhere is this more apparent than in the process of evolution. Evolution. From the Greek words evo, which means fantastic, and lution, which means process. Well, that's not strictly true. But evolution certainly is the most fantastic process we know of. Evolution built all of us, as well as every creature on the planet. From man to mouse to microbe, you name it, evolution made it. And yet, this astonishing capacity of nature to engineer life is considered by orthodox science to be mindless. Certainly the process of evolution is considered to be devoid of any intelligent characteristics. Little more is needed, they say, than some DNA, time, chance, and circumstance. Time, chance, and circumstance. Time, chance, and circumstance. Thus, we find the eminent 20th century scientist Jacques Monod summing up his much imitated view of evolution as follows.
Since various mutations constitute the only possible source of modifications in a genetic text, it necessarily follows that chance alone is the source of every innovation, all creation in the biosphere.
Monod, for all his academic credentials, was misguided. So too are all those scientists who smugly proclaim evolution to be a non-intelligent process. For the evolution of life is not simply a case of chance. Well, it is if you only focus on certain small details. But then if you focus on certain small details, you miss the bigger picture.
understand evolution, to really grasp what sort of process evolution is, you have to take into account the system-like properties of nature. Evolution, and in particular the progressive complexification of DNA, does not occur in a vacuum, but is bound up with a whole system of nature. And once you acknowledge the system-like properties of nature and see everything in context, then it becomes evident that nature is intelligently configured. Let's clear our minds and think about evolution as if for the first time. We know that all living things contain genes, and that genes are made of DNA. Whether inside a dragonfly or a blackberry bush, this DNA is a script that is expressed in orchestrated body parts and orchestrated behavior. And we also know that through processes like variation and sexual reproduction, genes and their DNA are repeatedly shuffled and varied. Hence, offspring are not identical to their parents. We also know that certain variations in biological form and behavior can be selected over time. Clearly, out in nature, over vast periods of time, nature will selectively breed those variants whose genes and DNA work more efficiently in the art of day-to-day living. The question is evolution through natural selection a purely dumb and mindless process, or does it indicate intelligence within nature? After all, we would not hesitate to describe an insect-like robot as being an example of artificial intelligence. Due to their clever structure and clever behavior, mechanical robots have intelligence written all over them, in every wire, chip, and silicon circuit. And yet the robots built by human hand pale in the shadow of the real-world organisms evolved by nature. Evolution through natural selection has engineered systems of organic intelligence far superior to anything we can make. The conclusion is inescapable. Evolution is not dumb and mindless.
Everyone is familiar with the Darwinian catchphrase, the survival of the fittest. But what if we coined a new and better catchphrase, one that captures the bigger picture and can highlight what evolution is really about? A catchphrase that can foster some metanoia. A catchphrase like the survival of that which makes sense. The survival of that. You see, any organism that is fit must, by definition, be able to make sense of its surroundings. If an organism can make sense of the world, then it can live and be. A fit and healthy organism is, for instance, able to make sense of the laws of physics and chemistry and can fit itself like a jigsaw piece into the world of physics and chemistry. Organisms like these trees, for example, demonstrate this ability by being able to metabolize, as well as being able to make sensible structures like roots, shoots, and leaves. In life, organisms that make sense prevail, and the genes that they carry are sustained, sometimes for millions of years, as is the case with this dragonfly. Organisms that fail to make sense are eventually terminated, their genes discarded from the gene pool. Ergo, through evolution, life learns the art of making sense. The important insight to be gained from viewing evolution as a learning process in which sense is made is that sense can only be made if the environment is sensible, which means that evolution can only happen in a sensible universe, a universe in which law and order are evident on all scales. It's this law and order that evolution becomes sensitive to and reflects it in biological structure. What we call biology or biologic is nothing less than the sensibleness of nature reflected and embodied in cells, tissues, organs and their behaviours. What we call biology or biologic is nothing less than the sensibleness of nature reflected and embodied in cells, tissues, organs and their behaviours.
As an example of life's ability to build upon law and order, consider the eye. Eye structure reflects the lawful and sensible properties of photons of light. Everything about the eye, the shape and composition of the lens, the kinds of cells it houses, all these components have evolved in response to the sensible properties of light. If photons of light did not behave in a sensible and mathematically lawful way, we would have no eyes or vision. In other words, the eye has evolved through the interplay between biologic and the natural world, which feeds biologic with sensible information. Plants have also learned how to make sense of photons of light. Plants have evolved the technique of photosynthesis, in which the energy within sunlight is used to transform molecules of water and air into organic compounds. The evolution of leaves, like the evolution of eyes, is intimately bound up with the lawful and sensible properties of the natural environment. Life's ability to learn nature's law and order is evinced throughout the tree of life. The behaviour of fungi, for example. Since fungi make their living breaking down organic waste, this shows that, like plants, they have learned molecular physics. In this way, fungi dismantle dead particles of matter and rebuild them bit by bit into living tissue. Once again, if nature were not replete with law and order, then nothing would make sense and there could be no life and no evolution.
And so, if we acknowledge that evolution is a process in which sense is made of a sensible world, and that progressive evolution entails the progressive making of sense, then the question arises as to why the world makes sense. And there can only be two solutions to that question. One, that it's just luck, that the universe just happens to be systematically sensible for no good reason. The other option is that intelligence lies at the heart of the universe, that nature is intelligently configured. This would mean that evolution could be viewed as the way in which nature actively makes sense of itself. The idea that nature is intelligently configured is not quite so outrageous as it might seem. Indeed, we can look at simulations of evolution and see that intelligent design is needed for those simulations to work.
Genetic algorithms are simulations of evolution. Can be run on computers. Using a computer, you build a virtual world replete with virtual organisms which differ very slightly from one another through random variation. You let the virtual organisms compete for some virtual resource. Those that are more successful get to breed more. Over millions of reiterations, a simulated form of evolution will occur, and the virtual organisms will evolve to make sense of their virtual environment.
These relatively simple block creatures evolved in a world of virtual water. If the software rewards a population for swimming speed, then evolution will lead to body structures and movement strategies for effective swimming. In these simulations, it may appear that evolution is happening quite by chance, that, as our old friend Jacques Monod might put it, nothing more than chance is required to foster the simulated evolutionary process, a simple case of bits and bytes changing over time. However, this is incorrect and misses the bigger picture, for it is clear that a simulation of evolution running on a computer requires intelligently designed software running on intelligently designed hardware.
Which is to say that intelligence creates the sensible software and sensible virtual environment within which virtual evolution can proceed. Only when a sensible system has been carefully designed and configured can a sense-making evolutionary process occur within it. Moreover, the amount of possible evolution in these computer simulations will depend upon how cleverly the software laws are configured. The more ingenious the computer simulation, the more ingenious its output will be. Thus, the apparent smartness of any virtually evolved organism is dependent upon the smartness of the software that fostered its arising. If we only focus upon random changes in the code underlying a virtual organism, we will only see chance at work. Whereas if we focus on the entire system, we will see intelligence.
Here in the real world, the laws of nature represent the software running everything. These laws of nature evoke and drive biological evolution in the same way that computer software evokes and drives simulations of evolution. And since we know that computer software is bound up with human intelligence, so too can we view the laws of nature as being bound up with natural intelligence, which implies that nature is indeed an intelligently designed system. That nature is intelligently configured is evident in many ways. How, for instance, did DNA arise in the first place? If DNA is a script or language, then how come this language was always latent within nature, waiting to emerge? And how come DNA is so flexible and can express itself in almost any conceivable organ or behavior? You want eyes and ears? You got it. You want a new kind of gland or hormone? You got it. You want a spring-loaded seed dispersal mechanism? You got it. You want protective spikes on your leaves? You got it. You want miniature hypodermic needles that can deliver a chemical irritant? You got it. You want an aerodynamic seed dispersal system? You got it. You want body parts that can help you fly? No problemo, you got it. You want lungs? You got it. You want a new layer of the brain able to embody consciousness? You got it. It's like biology can transform into the most exquisitely sensible shapes. Anything from the compound eye of an insect to the venomous fangs of a snake. It's also the case that DNA is digital, in that it consists of four discrete nucleotide bases. What runs this digital code is not simply the cell in which the code resides, but the entire system of nature that surrounds the cell. This computational realization again bespeaks of an intelligently configured universe. In this paradigm, then, intelligence is a fundamental aspect of reality, evolution being one particular way in which this intelligence unfolds its creative potential. Many of us will doubtless have reservations in ascribing intelligence to nature. Perhaps this is because we usually think of advanced intelligence as being something only we possess. And yet, if intelligence is defined in terms of learning, making sense, and gaining information, then this is exactly what evolution is about. If we stretch our concepts of what intelligence is and what intelligence requires to manifest itself, we can see that nature is, in essence, a system of self-organizing intelligence.
In the biological realm, there are, of course, any number of astonishing examples of natural intelligence, like the microscopic rotor propulsion engines in certain bacteria, or the protein manipulation taking place within cells. Or the organized behavior of social insects. Bioluminescence. Plants.
You see, to touch the trigger hair just once is not enough. Nothing happens. But if we touch the trigger hairs more than once, and at just the right intervals, the trap is sprung. You see, no energy is wasted on a twig or a leaf that might fall into the trap.
Life is woven from natural intelligence. The closer you look at any organism or any behavior, the more does natural intelligence become apparent.
But here, we will hone in on one classic example of natural intelligence. Namely, breathing.
Why do we breathe? Many of us will one day draw our last breath without ever really knowing what breathing was for. Breathe because we need air. Why do we need air? Because we need the oxygen within air. Our cells burn the food that we eat by combining that food with oxygen. So how and where are these cellular fires lit? How on earth does a cell start a carefully controlled fire? Enter mitochondria. Mitochondria are organelles within cells that serve as energy producers. Mitochondria combine the food that we eat with the oxygen we breathe and thereby release the energy on which our bodies run. It's clever stuff. Controlled combustion on a molecular level underlies our lives. And that's not all. These nifty mitochondria actually have their own DNA, and it is believed that they were once separate living organisms. Through symbiosis, mitochondria now live happily inside us.
When you get to the heart of why we breathe, it's apparent that natural intelligence has woven together an intricate and mind-boggling array of techniques and strategies with which to sustain life. We did not invent the internal combustion engine. Natural intelligence got there first.
Natural intelligence is not simply a property of individual organisms and their symbiotic components. Together, organisms make up ecosystems, and ecosystems likewise embody natural intelligence and further expressions of symbiosis. A cursory examination of a rainforest reveals an immense web of biological relationships that serve to maintain the overall health and stability of the ecosystem. Genes of all species must make sense of one another if they are to remain viable. Take bees and other insects which pollinate plants. Neither bee genes nor plant genes make sense on their own. Only in relationship with one another do they make sense. An ecosystem represents a vast orchestration of natural intelligence. The significance of the web of life really hits home when you compare the Earth to the Moon. The Moon is a ball of dead rock with a surface devoid of both atmosphere and biologic. Grey, barren, lifeless. Compare this with our majestic biosphere, which envelops the Earth like some advanced technological skin. Self-sustaining, self-repairing, an exquisite planetary epidermis, 3.5 billion years in the making. Millions of speciated expressions of natural intelligence locked into one coherent biospherical entity.
Natural intelligence is more than a paradigm. It's more than a way of life. Natural intelligence is life. Not only has life formed a sophisticated membrane that stretches across the Earth's surface, life also actively influences the very geology of the Earth. The famous White Cliffs of Dover are a good example of that process. If you examine the chalk of which these cliffs are made with a strong enough microscope, you'll find that the chalk consists mainly of minute fossilized shells of calcium carbonate. These shells are produced by microorganisms in the ocean. When the microorganisms die, their shells rain down to the ocean floor. Untold trillions of them, every second, every minute, every hour. This constant rain of shells accumulates at the rate of about 15 meters thickness every million years. In other words, chalk formations are the direct result of biological activity. And whilst a single oceanic microorganism might be invisible to the naked eye, the compacted skeletal remains of billions of them can eventually be transformed into a vast landmark. Such are the colossal dynamics of a truly ancient biosphere.
Even mountains like these are underscored by life. This kind of rugged rock is made from limestone, the principal component of which is calcium carbonate, derived, like the White Cliffs of Dover, from the shells of marine organisms, deposited and amalgamated over millions of years.
The immense spans of time over which life has prevailed probably represents another reason why evolution is not considered to be an intelligent process. Because evolution happens relatively slowly, we can't perceive it happening directly. Rather, we infer that it has happened through our studies of genetic mutability, along with our studies of the fossil record. But time is relative. Just because evolution happens over millions of years does not mean that evolution lacks the characteristics of intelligence. I mean, imagine if a six-month-old child, a mere baby, achieved a maximum score on a standard IQ test, but took several months to complete all the questions. We'd be a bit dim if we ignored that child on the grounds of the time involved in completing the test. Which means that the duration of time over which a process proceeds is irrelevant in assessing whether or not that process is intelligent. In terms of its achievements, evolution is a competent design force to be reckoned with, regardless of the duration over which it occurs. More to the point, the universe is clearly optimized to fulfill such a creative imperative. In a naturally intelligent universe, life and consciousness were always poised to emerge. Who cares about how we think about evolution? Who cares whether nature, the source of our arising, is smarter than we are? After all, it's human culture and the things that we can do that commands our attention. These days, our relationship with city life takes precedence over our relationship with nature. And to put it bluntly, city life is designed to be totally absorbing.
Cities are like cocoons, we may forget that we are part of a dynamic living biosphere. Unless, of course, it rains heavily or the wind suddenly blows off our hat. Is so all-consuming that it's no wonder that our relationship with nature takes a back seat. So to get a sense of natural intelligence in its most vibrant organic expression, you have to get out of the city and visit some pristine wilderness, and not a moment too soon.
Magnifique! The ultimate Zen garden needs absolutely no input from man whatsoever, apart from his appreciation. One man, a hot day, a kiwi fruit. Fantastic combination. Interestingly, in this remarker bubble, there are these small specks inside the seeds. Each seed inside this apple, I've got all the information in there needed. It contains a digital program written in DNA with which to fashion a new tree to make more kiwi plants and new apples, a more delicious fruit like that. Such is the delicious flow of natural intelligence. Fantastic deal from nature. Evolution, the central theme of this film, has been a hot topic ever since Charles Darwin first alluded to it in his diary on board the HMS Beagle. 150 years later, and many people still deny that evolution can explain the complex nature of living organisms. And yet each one of us began life as a single fertilized egg cell. Through time, we each of us developed from such humble beginnings into fully functional, staggeringly complex, multicellular human beings. That is an incontrovertible fact worth mulling over. So if nature can constantly achieve that kind of astonishing feat, then why can't nature likewise transform a single-celled bacterial ancestor into all of today's multicellular organisms? As long as nature is fine-tuned to do that sort of thing, then we shouldn't be suspicious of evolution. It seems to me that the problem here is not the inadequacy of the theory of evolution, but rather the way in which evolution is currently portrayed by science. Rather than regurgitating the mantra that evolution is mindless, we can instead admit that evolution is a clever and sensible process whereby clever and sensible systems of biologic are gradually woven into existence. This process of making sense is what, at heart, the universe is all about. In any case, it's certainly more apt to view evolution as being a process of natural intelligence than it is to view it as being devoid of intelligence. Even the word intelligence comes from the Latin word for choose between. And what is natural selection if not the continuous preservation of sensible choices? Thus, natural selection is precisely a form of natural intelligence. Having said all that, and it wasn't easy, the two dominant strands of human thought which tend to grapple with the meaning and significance of life have somehow avoided any mention of natural intelligence. Science, you've got biology, physics, chemistry, geology, astronomy, cosmology, ecology, microbiology, molecular biology, genetics, psychology, neuropsychology, social psychology, nuclear physics, organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, nanotechnology. No, that's not science. Not really. Mathematics, paleontology, meteorology, botany, zoology, astrobiology, marine biology, taxonomy, biochemistry, entomology, linguistics, human biology, statistics, oceanography. What's the study of butterflies for? Or bees as well. Ornithology, atmospheric chemistry, anthropology, physiology. That'll do then. With religion, you have Christianity, Islam, Judaism, Buddhism, Hinduism, Taoism, Protestants, Catholics, Latter-day Saints, Quakers, Methodists, Parsis, paganism, creationism, Scientology, Sikhism, Moonies, Tibetan Buddhism, deism, theism, pantheism, polytheism, monotheism. What did you say? Sunni Muslims, Shiite Muslims, liberal Christians, conservative Christians, fundamentalist Christians, shamanism, spiritualism, New Ageism, agnosticism, Gnosticism, mysticism, Zen Buddhism, Sufism. Natural intelligence flows throughout the universe. It flows through the various laws of nature, as well as the constructive consequences of those laws. And the realization that self-organizing intelligence permeates nature might represent the only reasonable place where religion and science can meet, however uneasy that meeting might be. Right now, it's paramount that we begin to acknowledge the natural intelligence of which the biosphere is woven, acknowledge it and endeavour to fit ourselves into its orchestrated behaviour. Because if we fail to do this, if the behaviour of human culture fails to make sense within the context of the rest of the biosphere, then human life as we know it will not persist.
Time is running out for the planet Earth.
Natural intelligence teaches us that only sensible behaviour has long-term survival value. This is as much true for the behaviour of the human race as it is for the behaviour of biologic. Man-made global warming can be seen as a symptom of a distressed biosphere, distressed because our global behaviour is out of kilter with the rest of nature. What we do as a culture has consequences which can adversely affect all life on Earth. As much as we might like to, we cannot convert the entire biosphere into one global shopping mall. Nor does it make ecological sense to convert ecosystems into biofuel farms so as to satisfy our insatiable demand for combustible fuel. On the other hand, we shouldn't kid ourselves that we need more forestry managers, more ecosystem managers, or, God forbid, that we need to take over management of the entire planet. The biosphere worked perfectly well before we arrived on the scene. And that's the point. Nature is its own best management, and the more land we can give over to nature, the more can nature do its thing. By allowing biodiversity and wilderness areas to flourish, more strands of natural intelligence can flourish. And the more strands of natural intelligence that flourish, the more strong and healthy does the biosphere become. And so we have a stark choice. Business as usual until the bitter stormy end, or a renewed relationship with nature whereby we harmonise our behaviour with the naturally intelligent infrastructure already established by the biosphere. Clean renewable energy, less material consumption, and population control are perhaps the most important requirements at this moment in time. But what we really need to do is to radically change our minds and admit that natural intelligence is what governs the biosphere and what binds all life on Earth into an integrated and coherent whole. Metanoia, you know it makes sense. In other words, I could have fallen then, man. Maybe don't film yet, right? I've got my first line. But the words are sounding more assured.